Good morning. We have some wonderful news for you. Next Sunday, we will have our first in-person worship service here at Heartwood since the coronavirus began. We'll meet in our fellowship hall in the Christian Education Building at 10 a.m. And there are a couple of things that we want to remind you of. First, we're asking you to RSVP by logging into Realm and signing up for the service. If you're not on Realm, please contact the church office and we can get you signed up. Also, if you don't have internet access, please contact the church office and we can sign you up through Realm that way. Interestingly enough, though, we need you to RSVP by the end of the day on Wednesday. That's because our volunteers need time to organize the layout for the room in order to comply with the state's coronavirus precautions. And again, they're volunteers, and they will need to be able to fit that into their own schedules. And that's why we need you to decide pretty quickly and contact us by the end of the day on Wednesday. Funny as it sounds, we'd like to remind you to use the restroom before you leave home. That way we limit the traffic within the church restrooms and thus limit the risk. When you arrive, you'll be asked to put on a mask and keep your mask on until you return to your car at the end of the service. When you approach the building, we'll ask you to please stand on one of the taped lines, just like you're going to Costco or Walmart or Home Depot. We'll check you in, and one of our ushers will seat you. The service will probably be much shorter than it was before, more like this virtual service. Unfortunately, there'll be no nursery, no congregational singing, no choir, no bulletin, no offering, nothing will be passed. We're asking that if at all possible, you do continue to give online and mail your donations into the church office. However, there will be a small box at the back for anyone who happens to forget or just didn't get that message. There'll be no prayers in unison. We'll have a brief response that we will project on the screen in the fellowship hall. Furthermore, there will be no youth group, no children's Sunday school, and no adult Sunday school following the service. The session wants us to take this one step at a time and limit our exposure and our risk. When the service ends, the ushers will dismiss each person or family unit. Please go directly to your car and leave the church grounds. And please do resist, I know, that great temptation to shake hands or hug someone that perhaps you haven't seen for quite some time. Perhaps it would be better for you to make arrangements with those folks to meet with them outside of the church property later on. And now we will have the ringing of our bell. We invite you now to turn to your bulletin that you may have printed off from the email you received on Thursday from the church office, or pull it up on your favorite device. And please join me now in our call to worship. Our call to worship is from Psalm 36, verses 5 to 8. Lord, your faithful love reaches to heaven, your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the highest mountain, your judgments like the deepest sea. Lord, you preserve people and animals. How priceless is your faithful love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They are filled from the abundance of your house. You let them drink from your refreshing streams. Please join me now in our prayer of adoration as we pray together with one voice, saying, O God Almighty, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, grant us, we pray, to be grounded and settled in your truth by the coming down of the Holy Spirit into our hearts, that which we know not, reveal, that which is wanting in us, fill up. That which we know, confirm. And keep us blameless in your service. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now I'll turn it over to Laura for our first hymn.
Good morning, Heartwood. Our first hymn is called, in the bulletin it's called God of Our Fathers. The printed version you have is called God of the Ages. It's the exact same song, just one change. So we're going to change into God of the Ages. But I want you to think as you either listen to this song and pray through listening, or if you're praying through singing along with me at home, I want you to think about the words of this great old hymn. It talks about how the Lord has been with us for so many things in the past, from wars, from pestilence. The word pestilence is in this hymn, and that means exactly what we're going through now, this sort of terrible diseases. It is a prayer for peace, and it is more importantly, assurance that God has been and will continue to be with us through all the trials of this world. Please join.
We confess, O God, that all of us sin and fall short of your glory. We are idle when we ought to be active. We listen more to gossip than the gospel. And when we are called to serve, we more often offer excuses than excitement. We hesitate rather than hasten when called to do your will. Forgive us, O Lord, our apathy, and grant us courage to become more like you created us to be. Amen. Our assurance of pardon is from Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 to 14, and John chapter 13, verse 34. As God's own people, be merciful in action, kindly in heart, humble in mind. Be always ready to forgive as freely as God has forgiven you. Above everything else, be loving, and never forget to be thankful for what Christ has done for you. Hear the teachings of Christ. A new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I loved you. Our hymn is My Country, 'Tis of Thee. Independence Day weekend. And one of the most wonderful things about the independence and the freedom that we enjoy in our nation is that we are able to worship God freely and without fear. And that's a really wonderful thing that we have in our country, that we can pray to God anytime we want, and we can worship Him in any way we want and where we are because of our freedom and independence that we have here. And so that's something that we can all cherish and celebrate this Independence Day weekend. Would you please join me in a brief prayer? Dear Lord, thank you so much for the independence and freedom that we enjoy in our country today. And thank you that we are able to worship you freely and without fear because of that freedom and independence. In Jesus' name, amen. Gracious God, we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry for this heavenly food, that it may nourish us today in the ways of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen. So we're going to continue this morning with our sermon series on 1 Thessalonians. On Paul's second missionary journey, Paul, Silas, and Timothy went to the Macedonian port city of Thessalonica. The church that they established there was made up of Jewish people and non-Jewish people both. Paul wrote 1 Thessalonians about 19 or 20 years after the time of Jesus. There are at least four themes to the book of 1 Thessalonians, and we're going to touch on two of them today. The first is Paul's thankfulness for the Christians in Thessalonica. And second is the reality and the problem of persecution. In today's passage, Paul talks a little bit about how much the followers of Jesus in Thessalonica mean to him, and he also mentions Jesus' return. And so now, listen to the word of the Lord. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 17 to 20. But as for us, brothers and sisters, after we were forced to leave you for a short time, in person, not in heart, we greatly desired and made every effort to return to you, to see you face to face. So we wanted to come to you, even I, Paul, time and again, but Satan hindered us. For who is our hope, or joy, or crown of boasting in the presence of the Lord Jesus at his coming? Is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and joy. You know, I'm sure that we've all been in a situation where we were separated from a loved one and we missed them. Maybe it was a parent or a child, or maybe it was a spouse or a person that we were romantically interested in, or maybe it was a sibling or a friend. As a matter of fact, I had a phone call from one of our members last week who has since moved out of the area. And this is a person I worked with very closely when I first came here to Heartwood. And I really enjoyed our conversation, and it was really nice to catch up with them. And I thought after our conversation was finished, I thought to myself, I really miss this person. And I'm very grateful to the Lord that I had the opportunity to talk with them. And that's how Paul feels today in this passage, as he says, we miss you. So it'd be a good time for you to pull out your sermon notes. You can follow along and see where we're going today. You can either pull them up on your favorite device, or maybe you've already printed off the notes from the email that you received last Thursday. First, we find that Paul, Silas, and Timothy are forced to leave. Then, we see that they are hindered by Satan. And finally, we hear Paul mention the hope of Jesus' return. Because today we are reminded that Jesus calls us to influence the people we love for him also. Well, first we find that Paul, Silas, and Timothy are forced to leave. They were forced to leave Thessalonica because there was a threat to the lives of the local church leaders if they did not leave. An angry mob had raided the home of one of the church leaders, a man named Jason, looking for Paul, Silas, and Timothy. But they were not there at that time. But they were threatened that if they did not leave Thessalonica, both the apostles and the local church leaders would be killed. Since Paul, Silas, and Timothy did leave, the church was allowed to continue. Now, this term forced to leave means to be literally torn away. It's a very emotional phrase. Paul goes on to say that it's only for a short time, and he still has high hopes of returning to Thessalonica to see them once again. Paul, Silas, and Timothy had greatly desired and made every effort up to this point to return. Paul was concerned about their spiritual well-being. He wanted to make sure that they continued to grow in their faith, because the leaders in the church in Thessalonica were authentic and they were committed to the followers of Jesus. But they hadn't had enough time to learn and grow in their faith to reach the level of maturity that Paul thought was needed for them to be on their own. They still needed the tutoring of Paul, Silas, and Timothy. Paul also wanted to see the followers of Jesus in Thessalonica face to face. Paul missed them. I've said this before, but Paul, Silas, and Timothy genuinely loved the people of Thessalonica, and they desperately wanted to see them again, both for spiritual reasons and simply because they loved them and they liked being around them. Paul wanted to continue to lead these people to Jesus. And Jesus calls us to influence the people we love for him too. But Paul, Silas, and Timothy were hindered by Satan. Paul wanted to return to Thessalonica, but each time he tried to make the trip, Satan hindered him. Now, we must remember that the main goal of Satan is to get people to worship idols, or Satan himself, instead of God. When Paul, Silas, and Timothy came to Thessalonica and shared the good news about Jesus, and people began to follow Jesus instead of the idols empowered by Satan, the demonic forces in Thessalonica stirred up opposition to Paul, Silas, and Timothy, and put obstacles in their way of proclaiming the good news about Jesus. The persecution of Paul, Silas, and Timothy, and the new followers of Jesus, and their leaders, was empowered by demonic forces. This word that the Bible translates as hindered was actually a military term. It means to place an obstacle in the path of an enemy force. In Paul's time, one tactic was to dig a trench or a moat to prevent the advance of an enemy unit. They would also dig up the paving stones on a road to hamper the movement of their enemies. And this is how Paul describes what Satan did to Paul, Silas, and Timothy in preventing their movement back to Thessalonica. It was a hindrance. It hampered them. It delayed them. But ultimately, the Holy Spirit overcame that hindrance. Historically, we know that Timothy eventually returned to Thessalonica and encouraged the followers of Jesus in that place. And by virtue of the fact that we are today reading 1 Thessalonians, we know that Paul was able to communicate with them, if not return in person. The Holy Spirit continued to use Paul, Silas, and Timothy to influence the people of Thessalonica to draw them close to Jesus. And Jesus calls us to influence the people we love for him. Well, finally, let's take a look at the hope of Jesus' return. Now, Paul asks three questions, and he gives an answer that is rather unexpected. He says, "Who is our hope, joy, and crown of boasting in the time of our Lord Jesus' return?" Now, we would probably all expect the answer to those questions to be Jesus himself, right? And Paul would agree in general that that is the answer to those questions, and that answer is indeed Jesus. But he's going a little deeper here to answer how Jesus is his hope for those he loves. What has Jesus given him to do that gives him joy? What has the Holy Spirit given him to do that allows him to boast in what Jesus has done? The answer to that is the followers of Jesus in Thessalonica. You see, God blessed Paul, Silas, and Timothy with his glory and joy because they've had the wonderful opportunity to be a part of what the Holy Spirit was doing in the lives of the followers of Jesus in Thessalonica. You know, I remember going to a conference once, and it actually was not a Christian conference. It was a secular conference. And they had a speaker who shared her story. And she talked about how she had been through a lot of challenges and trials in her life. And she talked about how her parents had always prayed for her. They never gave up praying for her. And she credited that commitment to prayer as part of how God had carried her through those challenges of life. I think that's a modern day example of what Paul is talking about here. Her parents were like Paul. Paul always believed in living his life from the perspective of Jesus' return. And as Christians, we would be blessed to do that too. Every generation of Christians that has ever lived have been blessed to live in the moment as if that moment were the moment of Jesus' return to earth, or the moment of our own going home to be with him. When we get to eternity, we too have the hope that we will be saturated with the glory of God for what he has given us to do for him in our lives. That's when we will have the joy at seeing the other followers of Jesus that are there too. People he gave us the opportunity to share our faith with, or encourage, or help. People we barely knew, and people that we loved dearly. Because Jesus calls us to influence the people we love for him. Would you please join me in prayer? Dear Jesus, please give us the opportunity and the wisdom and the courage and the right words to influence the people we love for you. In your precious name, amen. Our hymn is Send the Light.
Good morning, Hartwood. I chose this hymn thinking about this passage because you so often are the light of Jesus in the world. You have his light in you. It's said that darkness cannot drive out darkness, only light can do that. So maybe as you consider the sermon where we're called to influence others with a love for Jesus, maybe you know someone who's going through a dark or difficult time. Use this song to pray and to sing, Send the Light.
This morning we invite you to participate in the sacrament of Holy Communion. This is not a Presbyterian table or a Catholic table or a Methodist table or a Baptist table. This is a table for all who have accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Would you please join me now in the great prayer of thanksgiving, which is found in your bulletin. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God, because it is right to give thanks and praise. Would you please join me in prayer? Father God, on this Independence Day weekend, we are thankful to you for the freedoms we enjoy in this nation. We are thankful that we are free to live our lives as we choose, to live where we want to live, to pursue our careers, to spend our time as we wish, and to choose our own leaders through our right to vote. We are thankful that we can worship you in safety and without fear. Lord, we pray that you would bless our nation, especially now, with peace, justice, and healing. We pray for all the members of the military who are serving at home and around the world, ensuring our freedom and the freedom of other nations. We pray that you will protect them, give them strength and comfort them, especially on this weekend if they are away from their loved ones. We pray too for our first responders. We pray for all of our law enforcement officers and our fire and rescue workers who ensure our freedom by protecting our communities. Please protect them. Give them strength and wisdom to do their jobs well. Please keep them safe. Lord, we pray for our nation on this anniversary of our independence as we face the plague of the coronavirus. We pray, Lord, for those who suffer from the coronavirus. Thank you that you are there to comfort them, and please heal them. Be with their families and protect and comfort them as well. We pray for those who have not been infected by the virus, that you would protect them from becoming infected with the coronavirus. We pray, Lord, for all of our healthcare workers as they treat those who are suffering from the coronavirus, that they would have wisdom, compassion, and energy to care for those who are suffering. Please protect them and their families from being infected with this disease. Please bless us with a vaccine and an effective treatment very soon. Ultimately, Father God, continue to use the freedom we enjoy to bring glory to your kingdom. Continue to allow us to freely proclaim your good news for the eternal salvation of many people. Continue to use the freedom that you have given us to take your gospel of the forgiveness, mercy, grace, and salvation of Jesus Christ to our own nation and to the nations of the world. In Jesus' name, amen. Now I'd like to invite you to take a moment and lift up your silent prayers to the Lord. Please join me now in the Lord's Prayer as we pray together with one voice, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he was in the upper room with his disciples, eating what we now know as the Last Supper. And at that time, Jesus knew what would occur the following day on Good Friday. And so, as the host of the meal, he took the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Each time you eat the bread, do so in remembrance of me." Now I would invite you to take the bread, which you have prepared for our communion service, and let us now all eat it together. At the end of the meal, he took the cup, and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Each time you drink of the cup, do so in remembrance of me. For each time you eat of the bread and you drink of the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he returns once again." And so now, let us take the cup together. Would you please join me now in our prayer upon leaving the table found in the bulletin? Loving God, you have given us a share in the one bread and one cup and made us one with Christ. Help us to bring your salvation and joy to the world. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Of the gifts that many of us have given to the church over the past week, I now invite you to turn to the back of your bulletin as we say together our prayer of dedication. We bring offerings of love, O God, with the prayer that through these gifts your will might be done. We are ever conscious that your gifts must be accompanied by our desire to serve your holy will. Bless us in all that we would do and all that we are. Amen. Our final hymn is America the Beautiful. And now as our service ends, be at peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.